नमस्कार आईच्या या खाशेल्या करावे तुम्हाला सगळ्या की होकार। आज आमच्याबरोबर असा देशातले एक नामनेचे ऑथर ऑफ शिवा ट्रिलॉजी अँड नाव द रामचंद्र सिरीज अमिश त्रिपाठी। अमिश वेलकम टू द शो।
नमस्कार।
फर्स्ट थिंग, हाउ इज द प्रोग्रेस ऑन सेकंड सीरीज ऑफ रामचंद्र?
आई हैव स्टार्टेड राइटिंग नाउ, सो द फुल मार्केटिंग फेज इज ओवर, सो ऑल द मार्केटिंग इवेंट्स हैव स्टॉप्ड, सो नाउ आई हैव स्टार्टेड राइटिंग, जस्ट स्टार्टेड। सो ऑन एवरेज इट टेक्स मी बिटवीन 18 मंथ्स टू 2 इयर्स फॉर बुक्स फॉर द नेक्स्ट बुक टू कम आउट, सो That's the plan.
We are waiting, we will have to wait for another 18 months.
Yeah, utna time to lag jata
hai. Utna time to lag jata hai. Right, it's nice to talk to you on the next day of Dasara, after killing the demon Ravan. What can we expect in the second part? More twists and turns, I'm not asking you more details, it is very unfair to ask more details, but what can we expect from the second part?
You can expect some twists and turns, but I'll tell you one thing, yeah. About Sign of Ikshvaku, which I'm surprised, not too many people had got. As yet, there is a major twist in the Sign of Ikshvaku itself. There are clues to it, and there's a major clue in the last chapter as well. And if someone reads the description of the Vishnu temple in Ujjain, in the Oath of the Vayuputras,
correct,
last book of the Shiva trilogy,
yes,
that is also linked to.
Yeah, there's already.
That's also linked. The clue that I'm talking about is actually linked to this. The description of the Vishnu temple. It wasn't random. So there is actually a big twist in the Sign of Ikshvaku.
And the clue is here.
It was not put very obviously because, but I thought more people would get it. I haven't had more than 3 or 4 people, at least on Twitter, Facebook, tell me, I got this. Most people haven't, I'm surprised.
Okay.
But the second book, first chapter, that thing will be
revealed. So that's a very interesting revelation. The question is, why Ikshvaku? It's not a very common word, but you chose that word. What was the reason behind it?
I didn't choose that word, and it was a name that was very well known till as late as 100 years ago.
Correct.
Lord Ram, we all know, is a Suryavanshi king, a king of the dynasty of the sun god. So who was the founder of the Suryavansh, the sun dynasty? The founder was Lord Ikshvaku. Lord Ikshvaku was the son of Vaivaswata Manu. And he was the founder, so hence Lord Ram is a noble descendant of Ikshvaku, Sign of Ikshvaku. That's the logic of the name.
You dealt with what is evil in Shiva trilogy. Here you are dealing with what is an ideal society.
Right.
How difficult is it to deal with such heavy topics, yet keep them very engrossing, interesting, without losing that literary value?
You know, either it can be the most difficult thing in the world or the easiest thing in the world. I've realized that if you try and do it consciously, ki yaar mazedar bhi hona chahiye lekin thoda gyan bhi hona chahiye, you try and do it consciously, you will fall between two stools. If you just let the story flow, you must be aware of all the philosophies, you must have thought of those philosophies, and if you let the story flow, then it's actually the easiest thing in the world, because then I am not the creator, Lord Shiva is the creator. Correct. I am only a channel. So then actually it's the easiest thing to do.
When you decided to put all those characteristics in Lord Ram, which is the most important book that you relied upon? Is it Valmiki Ramayana, is it Ramcharitmanas, or you picked one trait from each one of these?
I think it's a combination of many, because Valmiki Ramayana, you're right, is the original Ramayana, and Ramcharitmanas is the most popular Ramayana today.
Correct.
Primarily because of the 1980s television serial. But there are many other versions of the Ramayana in which Lord Ram come, you know, different aspects of Lord Ram are shown. So, Uttar Ramcharit of Bhavabhuti, the Adbhut Ramayana, also credited to Valmiki ji, Kamba Ramayanam, the Gond Ramayani, there are so many. And, but I think the thing that stands out most about Lord Ram in all the versions of the Ramayana is his devotion to the law, that even he comes under the law. And that, I think, is something that all of us Indians could do well to learn. We as Indians, frankly, don't have enough respect for the law. And that shows in the problems that we face today. That's something we can learn from.
Correct, correct, absolutely. And you describe about two kinds of rules, the masculine and the feminine. Yes. How do you define those, and how do you separate those?
See, the masculine way of life and the feminine way of life has nothing to do with men and women. They're about two ways of life.
Correct.
The masculine way of life is a life of order, a life of laws, a life of truth, justice, honor. A feminine way of life is a life of passion, a life of freedom, a life of creativity. Neither way is better or worse, they're just two different ways of life. The masculine way of life at its best is very efficient, is very just, is very fair. But at its worst, the masculine way of life can be fanatical, can be very violent. The feminine way of life at its best is very creative, is very passionate, is very caring, especially of its weak.
Correct.
But the feminine way of life at its worst is very debauched, very decadent, very irresponsible. So there are two different ways of life.
And you also make a point that both cannot coexist.
Both can.
Okay.
The thing though is that we shouldn't judge either way of life. Both of them serve their own roles and both of them will always coexist. Mm. And the masculine and the feminine exist within us as well. Mm. But one side tends to dominate. Like those of us who are more rebellious, like I am, like most of us Indians are, we are naturally kind of rebellious people. We are a follower of the feminine way of life because we are passionate, we are rebellious. Those who tend to be more compliant, who like to follow the laws, they are the masculine way of life. Ideally, if you can find some balance between the two, that's wonderful.
Mm. You turned atheist.
Yes.
I know the story, but I want to hear it again. Why did you turn atheist? And then I'll go to my subsequent question, which is related to this one.
I turned into an atheist in the early 90s. Yes, I was an atheist for 10-12 years.
Mm.
Some incidents had happened in the city that I lived in at that time, Mumbai, which had troubled me quite a lot.
Mm.
And our entire gang, all of us, had turned into atheists.
Mm.
My father used to tell me at that point of time that, look, we are Indians, we are inheritors of a proud liberal religious tradition. So if there are idiots saying things which are not right about religion, it's our duty to speak out even more loudly.
Mm.
But I didn't really understand that. I was a teenager, you know, but teenagers don't listen to their parents too much.
That's how they should be.
My kid will become a teenager soon, I hope not. No, but I was an atheist for 10-12 years. I think writing the books kind of brought me back to faith.
Hmm. So when did that turning point came? Because of Shiva trilogy?
Primarily, yes. I was writing the first book, The Immortals of Melua.
Hmm.
As I discovered more and more about Lord Shiva, as I wrote more and more about him, I found myself being drawn to him.
Hmm.
And I think for someone like me, no disrespect to any other god, but if someone like me had to be drawn back to faith, no god better than Lord Shiva to do it, because he is the god of the rebels.
Correct.
You know, he is a rule breaker in many ways. So many of us who are rebellious by nature, we find him attractive.
I'm tempted to ask this question because of that journey from atheist to again a believer in Lord Shiva. You turned atheist because of those events in 90s which happened in Mumbai. The root of those events lies in the Ram Janmabhoomi movement. And today you are writing about Ram. Has life come a full circle?
You know, I think Lord Ram's message comes down to us across millennia.
Correct.
I don't think we should be looking at the politics of a few decades.
Absolutely.
In the life of a nation, a few decades are like moments in time. You know? And when we look at Lord Ram, this is one of the things I always try and emphasize. We must look at the message that comes down to us through millennia.
Correct.
Not what a few people may have done over a few decades. That's actually, I would suggest,
but
not as important as actually studying his texts and learning his messages.
Yeah. But the factor which led to you being atheist, you're gone back to it, exploring it differently, presenting it differently in front of the world. And that is much above the political narrative of Lord Ram or any other narrative of Lord Ram.
I never comment on politics.
Yeah.
But I strongly feel this, that there's a lot that our country can learn from Lord Ram. And there must be some reason that even today, after millennia, so many millennia, even today, if you go around the country and you ask people what is the ideal way of life, almost everyone will say, regardless of religion, regardless of caste, almost everyone will say Ram Rajya, the rule of Ram.
Correct.
You know, so there must be something about that that has captured the soul of this nation for thousands of years. We must learn from that, and I think today we need it. After so many centuries as a nation, we are kind of reviving once again.
Correct.
It would be wise of us to learn from Lord Ram.
When you look back at that period, when you decided to turn atheist, and now when you are writing about Lord Ram, what is the contrast you notice in yourself?
In myself?
Yeah.
I think, you know, I had knowledge of the scriptures when I was young, primarily because of the kind of family I was born into. My grandfather was a Pandit. The atmosphere at home was deeply religious. Both my parents are very religious, deeply religious and deeply liberal. We were encouraged to ask questions. But I was young, you know, the kind of questions that you will ask when you're young may not necessarily, because it won't have the weight of experience of life, in it. I think perhaps maybe that phase that I went through was perhaps in a way good for me, because when I returned to faith, I returned with some fresh eyes, with some fresh perspective. I had that knowledge already.
Correct.
But perhaps I've understood it a little deeper now.
Very frankly, what happens is that we are conditioned in a certain way from childhood. The images of God, the stories of God are created, recreated in our mind. They have been told, retold generations after generations. This undoing that you went through of maybe faith or religion or spirituality, whatever you may call it, allowed you to explore the same mythology in a different way. Do you feel so? That undoing ultimately led to a great doing.
Not so much that. Because the point that we must question everything, that is a part of the traditional Indian way. Lord Krishna tells us that very clearly in the Bhagavad Gita, that we must question. No one is beyond question, not even God. In ancient Sanskrit, for example, there is no Sanskrit word for the English word blasphemy. Because that concept didn't exist. Since the concept didn't exist, the word didn't exist.
There cannot be anything blasphemous.
Yeah, that was the point in ancient India.
Correct.
Nothing was beyond question. The point of atheism is not so much the ability to question, because even religious people questioned in ancient India. The point of atheism is to approach the world from a different perspective. In ancient India, we had many schools of philosophy which were atheists. The Charvaks were atheists. They weren't oppressed or attacked in any way, because it wasn't considered wrong in ancient India. You were free to do what you wanted to do. But there is a point of view of atheism as well, which is probably worth learning from. And I think in that perspective, perhaps those 10-12 years were good for me. And there's nothing un-Indian about being atheist.
Correct.
It's actually
absolutely
a part of our... we have that...
But then there is a process of undoing that you go through, mentally also, spiritually also. It allows you to have a fresh perspective at the same story, same character, same mythology, which millions of people don't get, because they always believed in that narrative, they always believed in that story. So they never looked at those characters with a different perspective which you had.
That could be one way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Another way of looking at it is, there are many people, friends of mine, who went through that atheist phase.
Correct.
And some of them returned to faith, some of them remained atheists. But why was I blessed with this story? You know, why not them? I don't know. You know, there are no simple answers.
Absolutely.
For things like this.
Yeah.
But I think if you look back at life, everything happens for a purpose. And the thing that I have learned is, from the ancient Indian perspective, there is nothing wrong with atheism. They weren't judged in ancient India, they weren't attacked in ancient India, atheists. You have every freedom to be what you wanted to be. You wanted to find God through various different routes, go ahead. You don't want to find God, go ahead. That's your way of life. Ekam sat vipra bhavata vadanti. Truth is one, the wise men speak it as many.
Why do you think we Indians always hesitated, at least in the modern era, to explore or to meddle or to play, whatever word we may use, with our mythology? Why we restricted our point of view towards a set of fixed stories, set of fixed characters, which you did in Shiva trilogy, which you are doing in Ramchandra series? Why did you think we hesitated to play with our gods, if I may?